Thank you very much. I'm absolutely delighted to be speaking here today, and I'm even more delighted to have so many familiar faces over on home turf in Ireland. So glad you can drag you all over, and I hope it's the first of many. But anyway, I'm Rachael. Until very recently, I was DOS at Sol Training Institute, just around the corner. And now I'm director and lecturer of the NA TESOL at UCD, one of the universities we have here. So I mean, I had a lot to say about meetings when I worked at a language school. I have even more to say about meetings now that I work at university. And that's what I'm going to focus on today, but I'm going to look at the kind of how meetings fit into the broader kind of perspective of communication. And I'm going to try and keep it quick because I perceive the lunch break and I'll be very unpopular if I go into that. Okay, so it's about communicating the right time at the right time. And I'm just looking at worst case scenarios. I'm going to bare my soul as well and tell you one of my worst meetings. And I'm addressing questions such as how many meetings are too many, and how long is too long. Why is it so difficult? So I'm going to contextualise it in kind of the language school context. And then I'm not going to say this is how we have effective meetings. I have no idea yet. But I'm going to propose some interesting kind of paradigms, like lenses through which to look at what effective meeting is. And then just look at it in the broader context of communication in general. And then we can have lunch. Okay, so what's so wrong with meetings anyway? Because it's kind of like this, oh God, meetings are awful, aren't they? And I have to go to so many. I've got a few little kind of memes about a general consensus, like meetings are just a little bit unpopular. But it is essential to get together, isn't it? You can't not have meetings. It's important to be informed. I've seen what happens when you don't have meetings and it's not a pretty picture. How many meetings actually really inform you and you can't think, oh God, I'm so glad I was there. It's really useful, rich use of my time. I'm judging by the laughter, but not many. A third of all meetings are completely waste of time. I've done some research into this. I've put a link up there. Poorly run, mismanaged, lots of things wrong with it. Meaning some managers waste over 2 months of their working life in a meeting. I've attended one meeting and felt like I've just wasted 2 months of my life in it. Never mind to go that over a year. So let's just have a look. Give a little laughter moment. What goes wrong? Like loads and loads and loads of things go wrong. One thing that can go wrong is the agenda's not clear or not sent out at all. Time scale's not specified, so you're like, well, is this going to be a 5 minute meeting or are we going to be there 2 hours and how do I fit it in with everything else? Inviting everyone, whether relevant or not, or not inviting the right people. Ineffective chair, I just think that's kind of good manners. When the time's up, it's up, or let one person taking over chair should facilitate that, but sometimes they don't. Too many meetings as well. Or not enough meetings so that it's kind of almost pointless because it's out of context. So like, well, I can't remember what happened last time. Or so much has happened since we had the last meeting, we can't possibly effectively discuss it. So that's kind of the tip of the iceberg, really. Let's have a look at this before I tell you one of my worst meetings. Managers can be lonely people, that's why we did this. I'm going to tweet it next week and have another look. But one of my worst meetings, and I'd like to put this forward and let everybody address this, but I just don't want to go over the time. I'd rather be under today than over. So my worst meeting, I think, was I planned this big meeting. I hadn't been in the school long. They didn't like having a new manager anyway. It's part of change management. I was making a lot of changes. The bigger context was it was a difficult situation to walk into. And as part of my needs analysis, I noticed that we had these two breaks in a four-hour lesson. It's completely disruptive. The students took up a lot of time to leave and come back, and it was just pointless. I said, let's have one break. Obviously, enormously unpopular with the teacher. I mean, you can imagine. My heart was in the right place. It was a good decision in the long run. But I thought, okay, this is going to be tricky. And I did everything right. I was like, I'm going to really walk with them. I'm going to tell them I know it's difficult. I'm going to sell the advantages. I'm about to walk in. I was like, okay, this is one of the hour meetings. I tried to keep meetings short to the lunch break, like less than the lunch break. But no, we're going to take the hour so that people can vent, get it off their chest. I was so good, did all my homework. Just before I went in, one of the students rushed up to me, Rachael, it's the two-year anniversary of the Libyan Revolution, so we're going to hold a big meeting. Can you please leave all the teachers to vent? It starts in 15 minutes. They like all of the students have made food. They've got it's such a high. It's an amazing event. So I was like, of course, I had to go in. And by the time everybody sat down, I had like 5.5 minutes to say, sorry guys, I know you kind of love your two grades. It's going to be one. I mean, it was awful. And no, I didn't give it any chance. So I was like, okay, that's starting tomorrow. Let's go. So I'm not being put up for no meeting, and I'm sure you all have your own meeting horror stories. Again, the aspect, why is it so difficult? Well, in a language school, I mean, wouldn't it be a great job if one of the teachers? teachers have their own timetables, some have other jobs to go to, some have other commitments, some, you know, a lot of time people, well, I'll go into this, but there's lots of factors why it's difficult to try and get teachers all in the same place at the same time. Content, again, it's making the content relevant to the teachers, and sometimes something's really relevant and helpful to you, but not to the teachers. It's things like the timetable. I mean, organising the timetable is hard enough without trying to find a space where you can get everybody together. Students, what we've had is, like, once a week we have this meeting on, say, a Monday, and it's every Monday, but the students don't let teachers leave the classroom. They don't care that the student, that a meeting was actually really important, that has a huge impact on their experience as a student. They just say, I just want to ask the teacher a question, or make small talk, or whatever it is. So the students don't understand how important the meetings are, wouldn't let the teachers go, hey, I don't know, I won't ask, but some teachers are paid for meetings, some aren't, some schools do this, some don't. That's tricky, asking people to give up their time and their lunch break. The most popular meetings I ever had were because we provided sandwiches. Then that budget was cut. The meetings were never the same again. I just found this, which I thought was quite interesting, because we've all got so much to say about meetings. I wanted to find some kind of paradigm that might be useful, a useful kind of lens through which to attack the concept of meetings. So autonomy, and when I looked at this, I kind of, light bulbs went off, because I can see where I've gone wrong sometimes. Autonomy, do the teachers feel like they can actually contribute, or is it just you barking things? Do they feel that what they say will actually be listened to and have an impact? Meaning, is what you're saying, or will they be able to immediately relate it? This is meaningful to me. Challenge, does this have an impact on the teachers, their classroom? Are you giving them maybe a problem to help solve? Learning, are they going to feel like, oh, I'm glad I did that, because I learned something new that I can use? And feedback. Do you refer to a previous meeting and give them, like, you know, I've actually taken part of what you said and I've taken action on it, and you can now see that action, or even within the meeting, keep kind of giving each other feedback on ideas that are being discussed. And scheduling and supporting. So scheduling, it's as simple as kind of picking a regular time, so I found really helped. Still, if it's say it's every Monday, it still doesn't work, people still forgot, so it's backed up with other things, but it's just something regular. I also thought, in fact, kind of taken notes while I was at these meetings, at the previous talks. So I'll go through these and discuss that. So how often? As often as makes sense, every school's different, you know your context. Pick a frequency and stick to it. I also thought, I mentioned provide food, but a selective agenda. Try and put yourself in the teacher's shoes, or even ask a senior teacher, say, listen, what's relevant and what isn't. I also thought of making some meetings voluntary. Now this worked, I did this once with the admin team. We needed to have meetings, everybody was too busy to attend it, and I kind of argued, it's when you're really busy that you need meetings more often. But anyway, but not too often. But I said, okay, so let's say we'll have an admin meeting once a month, but let's do them weekly anyway, and whoever wants to turn up can, and that worked really, really well, and again, it fed into kind of autonomy. I also thought, like telling people three times, whatever it is, tell them three times, the meeting's going to be next week. First time is if I think every week, you know that. The second time is put in my work. The third time is maybe when you're doing the role, or you're going around, tell the teachers it's going to be 6. People do forget, people are very busy. supporting meetings of what, you know, because lots goes on, like most Irish language schools are rolling enrollment. I don't know if it's as common in the UK as it is here, but loads happens. That is really relevant. So memos are a good way to back it up, but again, somebody said this earlier, don't think that we should put a memo up that people have read it and know it. But again, it's something that can back it up without being too intrusive. It's like, you know, these are the memos, have a look. If you want, if you think it's relevant to you. And the teachers who want to look at memos do, what they don't. Or maybe just a reminder, like we said in the meeting that we were going to do this, this is the day we said we'd do that. A teacher FAQ page, it's kind of similar to somebody kind of raised the issue with their handbook. Things that don't really change very often, and I've kind of pulled all the things out of the handbook and put them on an FAQ page because we had this really funky web designer create a really cool FAQ page for us that worked quite well, so it's kind of quite interactive, so that was nice. And as a course for cover teachers, last minute teachers, teachers who are new, you've absolutely no time to induct them properly, this is a good resource for them. And I also put the minutes to the meeting on a link at the bottom of that so people can access the minutes. And get useful information that doesn't change. The minutes as well, I just found nobody read that. I hated it. I didn't hate it, of course, very useful, but I held the meeting and then I didn't have time to write the minutes. And then it was weeks later, I was like, okay, there's a minute, did you all read it? No, because I wasn't very good at getting it to you on time. So I actually asked a teacher to take the minutes and they took turns. Small change, but actually really effective. Means at least one teacher was listening anyway. And notice boards, again, kind of similar to the memo thing, just a useful backup. It's kind of if you're referring to the syllabus all the time, then, you know, that's where the syllabus is kept, guys, so you don't have to trawl through minutes of meetings. Everything has a place. And then, of course, I think what's really important, kind of backing up what happens in meetings, the informal communication, bumping into each other, people on the corridor. And, you know, I think it was Josh who said it, it's all kind of managed by walking around. What was it? It was George. Everybody's saying it now after George was so managed by walking around, is that the right phrase? Just telling people as you're going along, backed up with other things as well, because you're not going to bump into everybody. And also, letting the teachers have space to communicate informally. I was just having a discussion with Mike over there about like attending the coffee break with the teachers. My teachers wouldn't have liked that, because it's the one chance to get off steam, usually about me, and that's okay, they needed that. They needed that chance to informally communicate with each other, so that then they were kind of on a level playing field when they came into a meeting, so they might have, even if it was formed a consensus against something I was proposing, at least they'd had the chance to discuss that. Come to me, so informal communication is very important as well. Thank you very much. I've done it. I thought I finished slightly earlier. Any questions?
Thank you much.
Space in the meeting for them to make that suggestion for the ideas. And how did that work?
It worked really well when we had sandwiches.
Okay.
People didn't want to rush off.
Yeah.
Sandwiches are the key thing.
Yeah.
It worked really well. I made a conscious decision when we stopped providing lunch because I know we weren't to have shorter meetings, and I did feel like I was just barking stuff at sandwiches. So I kind of tried to have maybe a one meeting a fortnight, I was just barking, so the next, the agenda was very, very scant, so that was space, and like a kind of ping pong thing like that, but I mean, I didn't quite get it right in the way that I would have liked to.
I've come across schools where the idea of the freelance does work very well for meetings. In some schools where they say that when we really want the teachers to go, we do provide freelance, and it seems to work pretty well.
Yes. One thing I didn't mention on this, but I found the location helped. So, you know, if it was in a classroom, they felt like they never left the classroom all morning. It's kind of holding it somewhere different. Or if it was a one-to-one meeting, if I was holding an important appraisal, I'd go off-site so that maybe just having your boss at some of the meetings. Just, you know, the director of the school is okay, me, but you know, the director should attend as well, so it's kind of location who attends.